with us and is born as a child. A child. So innocent, so pure, so fragile. Have you ever thought about that? And let me tell you, I have a problem with the hymn or the carol that says, the little Jesus, no crying he makes. Have you ever been around a newborn child? That's all they knew how to do at that point. It doesn't make sense. There's a sense of the squalor and everything he was born into. Why there? What does it look like for that Christ child to be born into a life? What does it look like for God to answer the need of chaos into peace, the need of lostness into home? What does that look like? Well, it doesn't look like what we often make it look like. We get so close to understanding, and yet somehow we still miss it. There's a little girl, she's 4 years old, so you can't really blame her for anything, that had the most marvelous Christmas she'd ever had. Her name was Mary. And she got every present on her list and some. She got to eat all of her favorite foods all day long, and not the healthy ones, the fun ones, all day long. And all of her cousins from the whole country were all together, and they got to play together all day long. And at the end of the day, as she was sleepily being tucked into bed by her mother, she got a big, wide smile, and she said, "Mommy," she said, "Yes, dear, I hope that Mary and Joseph have a baby again next year so we can do this all over again." She was so close. It's about the baby. But it's not about just any baby. It's about the baby, the one who is fully God and fully man, who came to be with us for us. Can that change a life? To explain that, I'm going to share a story with you about a woman named Nancy, a young woman. Although she sounds like Mary at first, it's not Mary from the story we just heard. She was young, she was pregnant, she was unwed, and she was far from home. You don't need to know all of her history. Suffice it to say that she had left home a long time before. She had kind of run away from the house. She and her father had a falling out. She didn't like his rules and things. She thought she knew better for herself, like so many teenagers do, but she took it to the extreme. And she ran away, and she lived with friends for a while until she burned those bridges, and with other people she met, and she was bouncing around and across the country, falling into crowds and kind of staying with them to find community that never quite satisfied her. She fell into some bad situations. She knew what it was with some little petty jobs to live paycheck to paycheck, more like meal to meal. She had missed some of those meals. She knew what it was to truly be hungry. Not, "I'm hungry until later today," but to miss days of food. She knew what it was to be truly alone and frightened, and she knew what it was to feel lost. She'd fallen with the crowd a few months before, and things had seemed okay at first, and she'd found a young man who she thought would change her life, and things seemed to go well until she became pregnant and she was out the door like any other problem he had. And now she's trying to figure out where to go. She thought about going home. In fact, she really desired to go home. It was Christmas, and she'd already loved Christmas as a child, and she was remembering all those fond memories of how warm and how loving and how wonderful it was to be there. But she didn't know the way home anymore. Well, she knew the address where her parents lived. She just didn't know if she was welcome or how to get back there in her heart and in her mind. And so she took to hitchhiking to try to get back to that side of the country, and some trips took her closer than others to get there, and even when she would have a straight shot, she'd find that she wouldn't want to take it. She was held back by her fear or her anxiety or her anger or her guilt. So she'd gotten one ride. She found herself in a little town. You don't need to know the name, because some of you have been in a town like this. It was a small little town, very quaint, probably in one of those movies we talked about earlier. Had one little main street with a few shops on it. And she thought she'd do what she's done in times past. She would go into town, and if she couldn't find a hotel with a cheap room that would let her have it at a super discount because it wasn't full, then maybe she'd go to an all-night diner, and she'd buy some coffee or a piece of pie or do something to allow her to stay and stay there long enough that if she fell asleep and it wasn't busy, they'd leave her alone. But this little town was pretty small. And it was a pretty old-fashioned town. It was Christmas Eve, and everything was closed. Even the Chick-fil-A was closed. But I mean, everything was closed for Christmas Eve. And when she went downtown, all the stores were closed. There was a little mom-and-pop pharmacy that was closed. And she found the diner that she hoped would be open, and it was closed for Christmas Eve. She rounded one corner, and there was a church on the side of the road that had wonderful, warm stained-glass windows, and she could hear the music inside. But it had been a long time since she felt welcome in a church. Some of it had to do with how she'd been judged when she tried to go in, and Some of it was because she just carried too much shame with her. So she kept wandering, and she protectively held her now swelling belly, thankful that she wasn't close to giving birth and looking for a place to be. And she rounded another corner, and there in the distance something caught her eye. It was a blinking golden star, not in the sky, but on the side of the road. It was the only thing lit up in the area, and it really caught her eye, and like a moth to the flame, she just wandered towards it, and the closer she got, she recognized there was something else under the star. There was something red under the star also glowing, and she got closer and closer, kind of made a game of it, trying to figure if she could see what it was before she got to it. When she got close enough, she stopped cold in her tracks. There under the star was her name, Nancy. It was like somebody was calling her. She sped up her walk to get there faster, and when she got closer and closer and finally got to the place, her heart fell within her because she saw the rest of the sign. Around the star, it said, Starlight Motel, all burned out. And under it was the red neon sign that said, No Vacancy. Most of the letters burned out, just Nancy left over. And a heart broke. She wandered up to the office anyway just to see if maybe the sign was wrong, if maybe they could point her to a way that would offer help. And the sweet old man behind the register there, the manager for the night, said, Honey, I'm sorry, we are full up for the night. We wouldn't have a room to spare. They even raised the rates, the boss did, to make sure that we got the best price possible. But he took in her bedraggled appearance and, more importantly, her bedraggled soul. He said, But you know what I can do for you? Why don't you come on in? My office is right over here. I have a really nice recliner in the corner. Why don't you go sit there and thaw out a bit? I don't have much to offer, but I have my thermos of chicken noodle soup I made at home. It's still hot in the thermos. You can have that and the crackers I brought, and I'll put on a fresh pot of coffee. Let me see if I can find some pillows and blankets to make you comfortable. And she found the help that she needed for that night. And as he went about his business to see what he could scrounge up, she was listening to the little transistor radio playing behind the counter there, and it played some Christmas standards, and then a song came on. Perry Como's There's No Place Like Home for the Holidays. It was like a knife in her heart. And she began to weep uncontrollably. And that gentle old man came back in. He dropped what he had. He sat down to ask her what was wrong. And before she knew it, she just couldn't stop. All the words that flowed out, her heart pouring out to this man of her brokenness and her shame and her fear of not being welcome at home and what she missed and what she wanted and being so lost. And after a while of her speaking and taking some deep breaths and drinking a little coffee to kind of calm herself, he asked her gently, Would you mind if I shared something with you? She nodded, sure. He reached over into his desk and he pulled out a well-worn little leather New Testament. And he opened it up and he began to share the story that we read this Christmas Eve, that the church, I'm sure, there and everywhere was reading. The story of Mary and Joseph and their trip from Nazareth to Bethlehem and how difficult it was and finding no room in the inn for them either. She couldn't help but catch on to that. And he finished the story and he shared about how God's love came into the world. And she said, But that sounds so hopeful. And he said, It is. Well, I need some hope like that, but why would God do that for someone like me? He said, I'm glad you asked. He thumbed over to another page in the Gospel of John and said, For God so loved the world that he gave his only son for Nancy. And Christmas came, and her heart was filled. And she felt so full of something she had not felt. In fact, she had never really felt full before. And the man said, Now, Nancy, I see something happening with you, but I want to say another word. You know you're welcome to stay here tonight, and I will help you get some more help tomorrow. But you know this isn't your home. He said, In fact, the only true home is not that one you're looking for. I hope things work out with your folks, but the only place you can really find home is in that child that was born in Bethlehem long ago. Because you needed help and you needed hope and you needed home, and he came to bring that to you because we can't go get it ourselves. And she received that wonderful joy. And she received that wonderful gift. She just trusted in that, and it changed her. I know you're all wondering what happened at the end of her story, but the reality is we don't know what happened in the story, but I'll tell you this. The journey to her parents didn't look anywhere near as long the next day as it had that day. You know, we need to understand what it means this Christmas for the Christ child to be born for you and for me. Our lives are filled with bedlam, with chaos. You might not think yours is as bad as other people's, or maybe you think it's worse. Doesn't matter what it is, God came for you. God came because he loves you, not to denounce you or judge you or cast you down, but because he wants to enfold you in arms and draw you into a love like you've never known. That's the true gift of Christmas given to you and to me. It was deep and wide enough for Nancy and for all of the world. And Lord, we give you thanks this night. We thank you for the Christ child born long ago, and we recognize, Lord, that you call us even now to receive the child into our hearts, that he be born anew within us, asking only for a little corner of our lives. But Lord, we also know you say in your word with fair warning that he will not remain a child. That he will grow till he is the Prince of Peace, that he is the King of all kings, that he will take over everything until our heart belongs to him. And we're so full of him, there is no more room, that he will grow our heart to make more room for him and for others still. Because the gift is given not only to us alone, but is given to us and through us for the sake of a world that needs him and the love he brings. And for this we give you thanks, and for this we praise your name, for his holy sake. Amen.
Like a drama unfolding, the curtain was opening, while an audience of angels were holding its breath. A census, a manger to travel-worn strangers, the stage was finally set. Angels folded their wings at the throne worshiping, as he whispered, I love you, my son. Jesus took off his crown and laying it down, he said, Father, thy will be done. The time had now come for God's only Son to be born as a light in a dark, lonely place. So he stepped from heaven's hall to Bethlehem's stall, where a star lit his newborn face. God called to Gabriel with gladness and tears, play the trumpet, the horn, and the strings. Tell the shepherd, the wise men, and all who will hear, command all of the angels to sing. Fill the sky with their voices and sing. Joy, joy to the world, praise to the King. Oh, let it ring. Joy, joy to the world, worship and sing. Jesus has come to bring joy, joy to the world. Joy, joy, joy.
please stand for our prayers? God of the manger, God of us all, we humbly gather our prayers before you as we prepare to celebrate Jesus' birth. We give thanks for his life, his ministry, and the hope that his very being can represent for us. God of humility and innocence, God of wonder and miracle, we give thanks today for your power and presence in our midst. In Jesus, his birth, his life and ministry, his death and resurrection, you have shown us that greatness can emerge out of vulnerability, and that with you, all things are indeed possible. Lord, in your mercy. Today, God, we ask that you guide our journey to the stable. May all your people gather this night around the Holy Family, bringing hopes, fears, joy, sorrow, delight, and most of all, love into our circle of adoration. May we hear the song of the angels as the birth is announced, and may our voices ring out with praise at the miracle of it all. May we be like the shepherds and leave here with amazement as if we heard it for the first time, telling everyone about Jesus' love. Lord, in your mercy. Eternal God, in the name of the tiny babe of Bethlehem, we pray for all humankind, for the strong and the weak, for the poor and the wealthy, for oppressed and oppressor. May all kneel together at the manger, seeking help, healing, and hope. Let us now bring our prayers of healing and concern for those we love and those who have asked for our prayers, either in the silence of our hearts or on our lips. Lord, in your mercy. God of comfort, swaddle us in the safe closeness of your divine embrace and bring us peace. May your name be praised and glorified on this day of wonder and forevermore. In the name of your precious gift, your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated.
Child is this who lay to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet with anthems sweet, while shepherds watch are keeping. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds
bring him incense, Lord. Please join with me in the Eucharistic prayer. We give you thanks, Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son.
You sent him to save and redeem us and to proclaim your will.
He is your word.
Inseparable from you.
He is your word.
Sent from heaven to a virgin's womb.
He took on our nature and fulfilled your will, winning for you a holy people.
He stretched out his hands in suffering and death to free from suffering those who trust you.
He arose triumphant
over sin, death, and the evil one.
Taking bread and giving thanks, Jesus said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Then again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to all, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering then his death and resurrection,
we give you thanks that you have made us worthy to stand before you and to serve you as your people.
Please join hands as you are able as a community. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Come to the Lord's table. It is the place where heaven and earth touch. It is the living presence of your Lord and the place where he gives his promise of forgiveness and new life. Come, believers, come and partake. All are welcome. You may be seated. Rejoices of the body and blood of Christ, given and shed for you. Bob, the body and blood of Christ, given and shed for you.
Someday, when this night is over, and the star has faded, and the angels fly, I will look at you with wonder, dreaming of this someday. the people.
Thank you.
body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. Radiant God, with our eyes we have seen your salvation, and in this meal we have feasted on your grace. May your word take flesh in us, that we may be your holy people, revealing your glory made known to us in Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen.
It's time to take out your candles if you have them. A word about, again, safety, how we do this. If you will keep the lit candle upright and tilt the unlit candle into it to light it, that would be the best way to do that. And then a word as we light candles, as you look around in a moment, and I'll go ahead and light these. You guys start lighting everyone's. I'm going to say this word. When my daughter was being born, or just about to be born, and my son, her older brother, was worried, he approached us and asked if there would still be enough love for him after she was born. And my wife, who is very wise, gathers together as a family with a handful of candles for a birthday cake. And light these where you go. And she had me light one and she lit one, and we held them and showed them to her. And she said, "Now, when we light your candle off of these, I want you to tell me if there's more or less light." And we lit his candle, and he said, "Well, there's more light." And she said, "What about this fourth candle that's for Lila when she's born?" And she had him light that candle. She said, "What do you think will happen then?" He said, "I think it'll be brighter again," and it was. And she said, "You know, that's the beautiful thing about love, that the more we give to others, the more light and the more love there is. It never diminishes what's there, it just adds to it." The beauty of these candles this night are representative of Christ's love and grace and presence with us. So as you watch the light spread and you watch the glow grow around you, remember that it's God's presence in you and for you for the world, and give thanks for that. And so we sing.
Silent night, holy night.
you'll carefully take a look around you at the beauty of the candlelight here, remember it just represents the joy and the peace and the hope we carry with us into the world. And though we extinguish these lights now, remember the light of Christ within you will shine forever, world without end.
Amen.
Let this hour not be forgotten. As you go to your homes, think about the true message of Christmas and share together experiences of love, joy, and peace. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Do you want my book? Since I won't be here for 6 years.